drawing on different empirical data from public debates, media representation, and also ethnographic studies of everyday life in multi-ethnic settings in Copenhagen, my presentation will explore and discuss issues of discrimination, tolerance, and coexistence in Denmark. So I'm not so much going to talk about the consequences of the Khartoum affair and on the climate, very climate of ethnic diversity and discrimination, but more take the Khartoum affair as an illustration on the of the debate on not only Islam and Muslims, but also on immigrants, ethnic and religious diversity, social integration, etc. So I'm going to start with the Khartoum affair. On the 1st of April this year, the following April Fool appeared on Facebook saying, quote, "The government and Danish People's Party," which is the nationalist party that has been a supporting party of the government for the past almost 15 years in Denmark, "they want to prohibit people with other nationalities than Danes to express themselves through music in Radio Denmark. The bill is a result of this year's X Factor, this musical competition, which according to Minister of Integration, Inger Støjberg, does not belong to Denmark's national TV station because all the finalists in X Factor ended up being people with other ethnic backgrounds than Danish." This April Fool was a kind of joking comment to what one may call the recent debate on the Khartoum affair in Denmark, which was in fact instigated by a television series on the on mosques in Denmark, and that television series raised a lot of debate because of the way of representing these mosques as very radicalized and violent. And the Prime Minister commended that one ought to limit the immigration and the freedom of expression of certain imams who had this kind of very un-Danish, as he said, attitudes. So this incident, or this quote from the Prime Minister caused a lot of discussion about the double standard of freedom of expression in Danish society according to the ethnicity of the speaker, and thus also started a big debate on who is entitled to freedom of expression and who is not in our society, which is in fact a quite new turn in the whole debate about the cartoons in Denmark. The question of power and the question of discrimination have not really been touched on by Danes before. By limiting freedom of expression to certain majority groups as an act of discrimination, the Prime Minister involuntarily discloses another side of the Khartoum affair, however seldomly addressed in Danish media. So what is the Khartoum affair? Some of you are quite young, and in fact the Khartoum affair is quite old now. I realize it's more than, it's like 11 years ago since it started in September 30th, 2005, where the newspaper of Jyllandsposten published 12 editorial cartoons, most of which depicted the Prophet Muhammad. In the newspaper Jyllandsposten. The publication was legitimated not only through freedom of expression as an imperative of democratic society values. The act was provocatively playing on the argument that freedom of expression grants the right to do such a thing. If Muslims want to become accepted and integrated in Denmark, they have to accept this. That was the kind of rationale behind the publication of the cartoons. The publication of the cartoons does aim at showing Muslims that in a democratic society one can be submitted to scorn, mockery and ridicule. The defense of freedom of expression was formulated in a polarized discourse arguing for the necessity to defend this democratic value, which was perceived as threatened by Islamic communities wanting to import Sharia to Denmark. And the editor of Jyllandsposten, the newspaper, thus expressed his indignation to the Muslim claim on particular religious rights, which he saw as incompatible with secularism, democracy, and freedom of expression. Some of you, or all of you, may know that this publication stirred a worldwide debate revolving around various issues. For Danish Muslims, and at that time, in fact, I was doing field work in various Muslim institutions all around Denmark. For Danish Muslims, what was at stake was that the cartoons was, of course, a provocation to the ban on images of Islam, in particular of the Prophet Muhammad, especially since some of the cartoons were kind of cruel. But additionally, it was also the timing of the event representing a culmination of the newspaper's already quite discriminatory line against immigrants of Muslim backgrounds. Furthermore, it was also the Danish government's reluctance to engage in any kind of dialogue about the cartoons. Also in the international scholarly debate revolved around the discussion on cultural respect versus liberal values and the question whether the cartoon affair should or should not be interpreted as a form of racism. But in fact, at that time, in 2005-06, the issue of discrimination and racism was not an issue you talked about when talking about the cartoon affair in Denmark. It was rather the violation of Danish values by Muslims that you talked about, violating freedom of expression. Right after 2005 and 2006, there was also this discussion in Danish society whether the cartoon affair had in fact led to more dialogue between people or more polarization between people. And I don't think you could say that it was either or, but perhaps both. And the cartoon affair might have led to an increased polarization between Danes and Muslims, illustrating the image of the so-called clash of civilizations between Danish and Muslim values and worldviews. However, the affair also appeared to have opened up a dialogue between people, and especially there were many attempts on both sides in Danish society to open up this dialogue, especially from Muslim institutions, but also from, for instance, the Danish television tried to show or make new series where Muslim actors were in fact playing the main roles and always kind of going against the common stereotypes about Muslims. So yeah. However, issues of polarization tends to prevail in Danish public discussion, and the cartoon affair has led to strong ongoing clashes between different segments in Danish society, and also with its many subsequent reappearances. For instance, in 2008, some Edding Manoj youth revolted against a reprint of the cartoons, which they saw as an act of racial and religious discrimination. So I guess that the issue of discrimination has become more explicit over the last years. Also in the form of, for instance, hate crimes, which is also something that appeared to have increased over the last years in Denmark, as I guess in many other European countries or other countries worldwide. A couple of years ago, I did a mapping of anti-democratic and extremist political and religious movements, which also showed an increase in, especially in right-wing movements in Denmark, which I also think is a very general image. But we're definitely creating a very polarized image of positioning different antagonistic groups in society. So the cartoon affair has in different ways been associated with discrimination, hate crimes, and also terror, especially marked by the incidents of February 14th last year, where the so-called terrorist attack by a young teenager of Palestinian background who shot dead a filmmaker on an event debating art, blasphemy, and freedom of expression, and later that day he also shot dead a guard at the synagogue in the city of inner Copenhagen, and the young guy was himself shot dead the next day by the police. And it was a very tragic incident, and the following days after, people were really debating if this could be considered an act of terror or if it was an act of a deluded young man. And today it is known as an act of terror, although there's still a lot of debate about it among the Danish common Danes. So while this incident once more revitalized the discussion about freedom of expression as an unshakable Danish value, or as something that should be moderated with, which is always the discussion about in Danish society, is it an unshakable and unquestionable value, freedom of expression, or should it be moderated? And it always divides people and Danes in these two camps. But now with this April Fool that I mentioned, it had also come to include issues of discrimination and issues of who is in fact entitled to have this freedom of expression, and thus also power relations, the issue of power relations, which is a kind of something entirely new addition to the whole debate. So I'm now going to continue with presenting some findings from a study we did of the Danish media, and it was based on a 2 month monitoring of 4 Danish newspapers back in 2011 that we did about how they were writing about Muslims and Islam. The controversy over the cartoons may reflect more general tendencies in Danish media representation of Muslims and Islam, namely representations based on an undifferentiated perception of Islam as irrational, oppressive, and traditional, which creates dichotomies between Danes, who are called modern and liberal, and Muslims, who are called traditional and oppressed, between these identities. So the purpose of our case study on Danish media setting and framing of Muslims, Islam, and also racism was to analyze how Muslims and Islam were represented in Danish newspapers and the role the media plays in the reproduction of racial and ethnic inequalities. But it was only a short study based on a 2 month monitoring where we found altogether 300 articles on Muslims and Islam and 40 articles on racism and discrimination. The issue of Muslims and Islam was most intensively covered by Jyllandsposten, the newspaper that also published the 12 cartoons. And Jyllandsposten accounted for almost half of the news stories about Muslims and Islam. In the overall coverage, over half of the news stories dealing with Muslims and Islam were negatively framed and restricted to certain kinds of topics such as extremism, terror, Sharia, freedom of expression, and women's rights. At the same time, other topics occurred much less, such as the social, cultural, and economic contribution to Muslims to Danish society, or more like everyday stuff about being Muslim in Danish society. And no stories about discrimination against Muslims. The negative stories commonly presented Muslim culture and Islam as a threat to democracy, Christianity, again freedom of speech and Danish values, contributing to a perception of an antagonistic and hierarchical relationship between Danes and Muslims, where Muslims and Islam are associated with oppression, religious fanatism, anti-secularism, and terrorism. This relatively negative portrayal of Muslims as problematic, different, and uncivilized not only sustains a production and reproduction of stereotypes and prejudices about the other, but also indirectly an enactment and reproduction of discrimination. And we also covered the new stuff from Muslims abroad, where about half of the new stuff was negative and the other half was neutral. And the overall priority given to certain topics provided a very negative representation of Muslims and Islam. And again, stories about extremism, Sharia, etc. And the way that it was framed was really serving as a kind of frightening picture of how the future in Denmark may become like if Islam became more widespread. The analysis of the media and coverage of Muslims and Islam also showed that the reporting tended to be rather one-sided and exclusive of minority voices. You practically didn't hear any Muslim voices, only voices of those the few ones who always are commenting to the news. So our results illustrate the definition of Islamophobia, which one can define as representing Islam as monolithic, as separate and other, as inferior to the West, as violent, aggressive, threatening, as supportive of terrorism and engaged in a clash of civilizations, as a political ideology and as something used for political or military. So in a way you could say that the media representation was making these very Islamophobic images of Islam, which is perhaps not so strange, because Denmark is among the countries that rank highest in statements of having witnessed discrimination, especially ethnic discrimination and also religious discrimination. The terrorist attack, or what was termed the terrorist attack in February last year, led to several incidences of hate crimes against Muslims in Denmark, such as assault on, for instance, women with headscarves, but also desecrating Muslim graves and vandalizing mosques. Stories that were also heard in other places around the world. And according to the Danish Institute for Human Rights, hate crimes against religious minorities is one of the top priority areas in Denmark. But often, when speaking about hate crimes, we suggest hate crimes against Jews or the Jewish population in Denmark, which has a certain kind of special status, in fact, also in the law, in the anti-discriminatory law, which directly targets anti-Semitism. And it has been criticized by the Danish Institute for Human Rights that the law doesn't really deal with Islamophobia in Danish society. Although, of course, anti-Semitism and Islamophobia are related problems. Both cases, dealing with an entire group of people who are put under suspicion and discriminated against due to their religion. And this lack of focus on Islamophobia is quite noteworthy, seen in the light of the this the predominant negative discourses on Muslim minorities in Denmark, and which have been noted for now, in fact, decades, especially by the European Commission Against Racism and Intolerance, and in their reports on Denmark, that especially points to Muslims as targets of discrimination. And for instance, the 2006 report of the European Commission Against Racism and Intolerance pointed to the special problem areas such as the climate of intolerance and, against minorities, particularly Muslim minorities, and particular in the way that the media and also the politicians tend to speak about Muslims and Islam, the European Commission saw was a bit in a very polarizing manner, in fact, as having polarizing effects. So the role of the Danish media in creating negative images of ethnic minorities was already pointed out in a report in 1998. The publication of the third ICRI report coincided with the Danish cartoon affair, which initiated again a heated debate about Muslim minorities in Danish society, and very much trying to defend oneself against the report of the European Commission, and in no way acknowledging that there were any discrimination against Muslims going on in Danish society. Overall, how come it's not that people are evil, but I think it has to do with the way that that we tend to understand discrimination in Danish society, and also in many other societies where there's this conceptual double bind in the discourse on discrimination, meaning that discrimination is something that we've seen as representing certain groups in our history, for instance, Jews or black slaves, certain groups, certain times, certain places, but it's not something that really occurs in our current society. So there is this denial of ethnic, racial or religious discrimination going on in our society, except from certain groups such as Jews, which are kind of associated with the term of discrimination. There's also a tendency to make the issue of discrimination a very individual case. It's not something that goes on in, or is in lacing the structures of our society, but it is an individual act against individuals. It's seen in that way, and that also means that discrimination in certain ways is perceived as something self-inflicted, that if you don't know your rights in society, then you risk being discriminated against, and then it's almost your fault. And for instance, there have been cases where Muslim women wearing the hijab have difficulties finding a job, and where that the public meaning is that it's their own fault, simply because they don't want to get rid of their headscarves. So that's also an example of seeing discrimination as something self-inflicted, because you belong to a different tradition, to a different culture, to a different religion that is not tuned with Danish society. That's very much the image or the way that this kind of discrimination is perceived. And in spite of predominant ideas of Denmark as a society based on equality and freedom of expression, Muslims in many ways have an inferior position in Danish society. Also the way that they are positioned as a religious minority. where they don't have, they haven't become integrated into the system of religious privileges in the same way as other minority groups, and thus have a more inferior position. So, what does all this say about diversity and social integration into the nation states? The cartoon affair very much has to do with diversity, and according to the British anthropologist Richard Jenkins, who in fact has done a lot of field work in Denmark, the drama of the cartoons revolved around a conflict between two important ideological themes in Danish national identity, the theme of sameness and the theme of tolerance, which are themes that are very much part of Danish self-perceptions. Tolerance relies on the conditions that people are same, which becomes very difficult to sustain in a situation characterized by diversity. And multicultural respect is in conflict with the Danish notion of sameness, which is in turn associated with the notion of a monocultural unity of geographical smallness and economical well-being. So in that sense, the issue of equality, but equality as sameness, is very much part of a Danish self-understanding or of a Danish civil culture. But that also, but that also makes it very difficult to be different. Everything that does that really look like what is us becomes expelled at something which is other or different. And that is also reflected in the very concept of integration in Denmark, which is generally used in the sense of assimilation, of becoming like us, of cultural sameness. And the question of integration often becomes a question of the immigrants' cultural capacity to harmonize their values with the so-called Danish values, and to focus on this cultural sameness. And if minority groups are not willing to do this, or they are simply not considered fully integrated into Danish society. And therefore there's also a kind of a hierarchization going on in terms of which immigrant groups are more compatible with the Danish culture and identity, where Muslims are always positioned somewhere in the bottom of all this, and where the polarization between us and them in Denmark is always about us Danes against them, the Muslims. Muslims meaning everything that is foreign, immigrant, everything that doesn't really belong. At least when you interpret the discourses on it. So, definitely there's this polarization going on between being Muslim and Danish in Danish society. And it is very much verbalized in the public debate, but how does it look like in everyday life? And now I'm turning to the second part of my paper, which is based on this. A very old image from, I think, the 60s. This is a multi-ethnic social housing in Copenhagen, which was constructed in 1960s. And the picture is from about then. It has changed a lot since then, but I did field work in that neighborhood a couple of years ago. And it is called a multi-ethnic neighborhood because about 50% of the residents who are living there have an immigrant background. Many people who live there have a non-Western immigrant background, Muslim background, but have also lived there since the late 60s, where the latest wave of labor market immigrants arrived in Denmark. Many people mostly from Turkey, Pakistan, ex-Yugoslavia, Lebanon. And I settled to do field work in this neighborhood because after having studied the discourse and debate on social integration for so long, the question in my mind was, well, how can people in fact live together? So I set to do a study, a research study on neighborhood relationships among people in this neighborhood. Yeah, and when interviewing one of the guys living there, an ethnic Danish guy called Paul, who was 72 years old, he had been living there the most of his life, or at least last 30 years, and he was talking about his relationship to his Muslim neighbors and the conflicts of the Mohammed cartoons, and Paul said to me, I wouldn't mention it that he was annoyed about the Muslim reaction to the publication of the cartoons. Well, if they, his Muslim neighbors, asked what I thought about it, I would have said, I think it's nonsense that they were annoyed about the publication. But I wouldn't knock on their door and ask them straight ahead, don't you think it's bad to be annoyed about the cartoons? Because they have their opinion and I have mine. But I still think it's baloney. So what Paul expresses here is the lack of importance to conflicts in everyday life and diversity and disagreements as something that you simply live with. And in this part I will illustrate the way that issues of diversity are played out in everyday life using this neighborhood, which I call Green Park, as an empirical case. Green Park was, as I said, a multi-ethnic social housing estate, and when I was doing field work, there was a lot of attention to it because of vandalism and other issues, and also because it was almost on the verge of being categorized as a ghetto. And that identity as a ghetto was very much present among the people living there. Different perspectives on cultural diversity were at stake among the residents of Green Park. The national rhetoric on cultural diversity in urban spaces revolving around ghettoization as a social stigma had an effect on their perceptions of their residential area. Aware of the ghetto as a possible marker for Green Park, they would accuse the ethnic minority residents for developing the area into a ghetto. Ethnic majority residents often reproduced dominant stereotypes of immigrants as problems or as unintegrated, that they were not integrated enough, or that they were violent, or people with different mentalities. Of course, they also mentioned religion. In fact, they especially mentioned religion if they thought that they were too extreme in some way, and always hinting at Muslim religion or Islam as especially problematic in relationship to fanatism, to gender oppression, to violence, etc. Ethnic minority residents harbored stereotypes about their ethnic majority neighbors also, so it was not only one way, it was reverse. such as their implicit demands for assimilation and sameness, and such comments allude to the Danish dominant rhetoric that conceptualizes integration as an assimilation into Danish culture and society. So in that way, the whole debate about integration, social integration, and what is required to integrate in the meaning of assimilate to Danish society was something that people were in fact very influenced by in their discussion of it. But they were also contesting it. Generally, the way that residents talked about one another reflected this us versus them relationship. that prevailed in public Danish debates. However, they were, the residents were also very much aware of their own stereotypes about one another and about their prejudices about one another, and they also expressed a need for transcending these stereotypes. The majority of residents were aware that the media and public debates on immigrants and social integration of the effect that the media and public debates had on their immigrants, had on their perceptions, their own perceptions, while ethnic minority residents expressed the necessity to move beyond their own stereotypes about ethnic Danes. And the resident would often go against the cultural essentialist representations of Danes and foreigners, expressing an alternative discourse that reflects an alternative narrative that reflects a more complex complexity with respect to identities, thus indicating more multifarious ways, in fact, of being Danes, immigrants, Muslims. Yeah, but however, the residents' negative perspectives on Green Park as developing into a ghetto because of the presence of so-called problematic ethnic minority residents and their articulation of us versus them relations were also contrasted by their own daily engagements in rituals of courtesy. For instance, when I asked people about their neighborhood relationships, they had many difficulties speaking about it, and I think it's because that, in fact, living in a residential area and being neighbors is not really something you think about, because that's where you have your home. So they had many difficulties reflecting about the nature of neighborhood relations, And when I asked them if they had any relationships to other people of other ethnic backgrounds, they would say, no. We Danes and immigrants, we don't have anything to do with each other. We don't have any relationships of whatsoever. And they would speak about Danes and immigrants as very separate groups nothing to do with each other, that were closed, and they would kind of accuse each other of who would be more closed or who was guilty of this way of having no relationships at all. But in practice, when I observed, because I was doing field work in the area, and when I observed what was going on in the neighborhood, and also when I asked the residents to come up with examples of how they would engage with the neighbors, then they in fact revealed many different kinds of relationships also across ethnicities, and they would engage with each other on a daily basis, not only through greeting each other and chit-chatting a bit with each other, but also helping each other and exchanging with each other. And some of these relationships, especially relationships of help, were quite comprehensive, you could say. But people didn't really, their narratives on neighborhood relations indicate the separation, but their practices completely contrasted with what they said they did. So such contrast between narratives and practices reflect also a complex social reality defined by ambivalences between conflict and conviviality, discrimination and intersubjectivity, which I'm going to talk about now. One resident, 35-year-old Martin, who was born in the neighborhood of Green Park, and most of the first time I heard Martin mention the foreigners as people already often talked about or termed it. The foreigners of Green Park, he talked about some of the youngsters in Green Park who engage in different forms of vandalism. And he explained their behavior as an expression of their mentality, that it was because of their mentality that they were violent. And he generally talked about people of immigrant descent as social scoundrels who were exploiting the Danish welfare system. Yet he mentioned his two neighbors, both of immigrant descent, as exceptions to foreigners' general behavior. The two neighbors were among the few people of immigrant descent in Europe. His contact with them meant a lot to him, although it constituted primarily greeting each other, saying hello to each other. He said, "They're just like us," adding, "I talk to everybody here, because I don't care whether you are black or white or red or blue." Answering my question about how he experienced living in a multi-ethnic neighborhood, he said, "I don't notice it." Although Martin did speak about the cultural differences, as he termed it, in Green Park, and he primarily talked about Muslim clothing, about halal food, he said that he did not care about how others lived their lives. Besides, he thought that they also had something to offer him in his everyday life. Still, he pointed to the necessity of foreigners to conform, as he said, to the norms and rules of Danish society. When speaking about integration, when trying to explain what he meant, he mentioned his two neighbors who always greeted him and occasionally engaged in chit-chatting with him when meeting him, something he perceived as an expression of societal participation. Martin's talk appears to compromise several obscurities, contradictions, and ambivalences about cultural diversity and integration. On the one hand, he shows an attention to culture and cultural differences, but on the other hand, he gives emphasis to an identification with the foreigners and claims indifference or pragmatism to cultural differences. And his talk expresses a complexity illustrating that attitudes toward immigration and integration often are self-contradictory and confusing because they are formed by diverse vernacular discourses that do not fit standard ideologies but are easy to remember and easy to repeat. This complexity also applies to the way that different relationships and attitudes of tolerance and intolerance intersect. Martin's talk about the foreigners on the one hand as problems and on the other hand as his good neighbors reflect intersections between intolerance and tolerance and illustrate the coexistence of privately held prejudices but also of rituals of courtesy in public space. In Martin's case, living next to foreigners, as he called them, and engaging in gestures of recognition may create feelings of connection, translating abstract others into concrete ones. Still, the contact he had to these neighbors did not really influence his general perceptions about people of immigrant descent, and of how they were violent, etc. For Martin, the diversity of Green Park was not a problem in his everyday life, and he did not care about his neighbor's skin color. The residents did generally not attach attention to the various ethnic, religious, cultural, and so forth differences in Green Park. It was not something they reflected on. Sometimes they referred to minor conflicts that they associated with cultural differences or behavior which took place in Green Park's public areas. For instance, ethnic minority residents would respond to the majorities walking around drunk. Danes love to drink beer. Or walking around half naked when the sun appeared. Or the ethnic Danish residents would comment when the people with the women with Turkish background and headscarf were sitting in the lawn and having a picnic. But nothing else than that during my field work. Also during my field work, residents only on rare occasions, in fact, embarked on a spontaneous talk about diversity in Green Park. It was not really something people talked about. And when talking about it, they mainly pointed to language, religion, food, smells, alcohol, noise, clothes, gender roles, conceptualizing diversity as a social fact. When answering my questions about how they experienced living in a multi-ethnic neighborhood, they often did not really care about the existence of cultural diversity in the neighborhood. They would express ideas about following rules in Denmark without having to abandon their own culture or religion. And thus, the residents did not engage in the public debate on right or wrong culture or culture as an obstacle to integration. Most of the time, people in Green Park showed a pragmatism toward the question of cultural and religious diversity. After all, people lived their everyday lives inside their private homes and did not care so much about the outside surroundings. And also, they had this notion that that there was a divide between what was public and what was private, and of course, people had the right to live the private lives the way they wanted to and cultivate whatever religion or whatever they want to in private. Yvonne, who had lived in Green Park for 10 years, expressed clearly that the question of ethnic identity or difference was less important than sharing place and having one's home in Green Park. She said, "I think it's totally unimportant what nationality my neighbor has, but I also presume that, well, we have our lives here. We are perfectly able to be friends even though we don't have the same nationality and language and political conviction and religious and sexuality and so forth. In fact, I couldn't care less about that, but what we do have in common is that we live here and that we want to have a nice place to live. It's our home, this place." The residents' indifference towards issues of cultural and religious diversity appear to be related to the general ways of practicing neighborhood relations based on common experiences of living in that particular neighborhood. In Green Park, the visible presence of immigrants was generally not experienced, or was the general experience as a normal part of social life, constituting a commonplace diversity, which is a term coined Susanne, by the German anthropologist Susanne Wiesendorf. This way of observing differences but not really paying attention to them, seeing diversity as something normal. This lack of interest in diversity may thus reflect a habit of seeing the strange as familiar, based on principles of multiplicity as a defining norm and of co-presence in terms of being on common ground. Martin and other residents often spoke about integration as a political concern, in the sense of conforming to norms and rules of Danish society. Yet they used this discourse without any clear notion of what it implied. At the same time, they were attentive to the current subjects in the debate on Danish immigration and integration politics. They expressed various opinions and positions on these matters, agreeing, disagreeing, or showing unwillingness to engage with this debate. 50-year-old Torben, who had lived most of his life in Green Park, commented on integration. "Don't focus on integration, it proceeds automatically. Focusing on it creates a lot of insecurity." Many of those who expressed pragmatism towards the matters of diversity and integration were ethnic majority residents who were wary of the public debate on integration or simply did not care about the issue of integration. Their relative lack of interest in integration issues thus indicates a contrast between how issues of integration and inter-ethnic relationships are dealt with in everyday life and how they are represented in the political arena. Many residents talked about the possible negative influence from the public debate on immigration and integration on their own neighborhood, and were in fact quite cautious about it, how the national debate influenced their local neighborhood. They thus reflected consciousness about the continuity between the overall national societal macro level and the micro level constituted by their social housing estate. Some clearly expressed that they did not approve of the public debate on integration, which they found too cruel and which they thought had a harmful effect on the social relations in Green Park. Their critique included the different kinds of integration political initiatives, which were also going on in Green Park, since there had been a lot of attention to the issue of ghettoization in Green Park. The community had introduced a lot of integration programs aimed at especially the immigrant population. And the majority population perceived these integration projects as patronizing in their way of focusing on certain groups, mainly people with a non-Western descent, instead of involving everybody who were living in Green Park. By that, the residents emphasized, one may say, other dimensions of integration as a reciprocal and quiet process taking place in localities and thus revolving around ways of belonging, and also as a reciprocal process where people of all kinds of backgrounds are involved because they belong to the same place. So, to conclude, so my point of departure has been the cartoon affair, and I think I have taken us quite much around in the Danish landscape. But the cartoon affair, as I also said, an illustrative case for the debate on diversity, Muslims, immigrants, and integration in Danish society, and also as something relating to discrimination. I have tried to focus or compare how these issues are dealt with both in political life, in the public debate, and in everyday life in local neighborhood. And one may perhaps say that see a tendency in public debate, an increasing tendency over the past decade to a more polarizing discourse on immigrants, contrasting so-called Danish values with especially with Muslim values, and always taking freedom of expression as an example, as almost being a mantra in Danish society. And although there are many different positions on that, it is a mantra that is being kept alive constantly. But we can also say that there has been a kind of development since the cartoon affair started, and that the debate has become more nuanced also with the questioning of who in our society does in fact have or is in fact entitled to have this freedom of expression. And that was something that was an issue that wasn't raised 10 years back. But in that way, the debate has become more nuanced and also more contextualized in terms of different groups in society and different power relations. But on the other side, the public debate is very polarized still in terms of the way we debate social integration, immigration, social integration, which tends to construct this image of populations that exist or live separated lives, and only don't have anything to do with each other. In everyday life, however, we see that in many ways we see residents, and in that way the residents both affirm and contest these very dominant representations of inter-ethnic relationships going on in Danish society. People are not going about in this neighborhood killing each other. And so what I think is the overall picture is coexistence, despite, of course, being different and despite disagreement also, and of seeing diversity as a part of everyday life.